concluding session of this workshop, in which we have on the panel Sonita Singh, a friend from NEN, Dr. Anita Gupta, the senior scientist from Department of Science and Technology, Professor Amarnath, whom I have requested to chair the panel, to moderate the panel discussions, Mr. Praveen Gandhi, our friend and mentor and a director on the board of SAIN, and of course I myself. So since you have already heard the three of the panelists earlier in the day, I would like to request Praveen Bhai to share some of his thoughts, particularly on angel funding and VC funding, as seen from the funder's perspective, what they look for amongst the entrepreneurs who come to them for funding, and more importantly, what kind of support they expect the incubators to give such people in the matters of funding, networking, etc. So Praveen Bhai, could you just share your thoughts for 5 minutes?
Yeah. Just as a matter of background, I've been involved in funding early stage companies since year 2000. And personally, I've been an entrepreneur the life before that, which are many years. And currently also, we are running a fund which is, again, meant for early stage. So I have one great amount of interest in this space and a great amount of empathy for this space. What is, and pardon my, I am not, if at all I sound critical, please don't take it personally, but, you know, I just sometimes like to call spade a spade and, you know, show my frustrations. So one of the biggest learnings that we have had since we started this fund is that the quality of entrepreneurs that we create are just not up to speed. Lot of the stuff that should have been done prior to them becoming somewhat of a full and running entrepreneurs, we end up doing to the extent of even, you know, what it means about shareholding in a company, registration of a company, etc., etc., etc. So that is very frustrating. But besides that, those things can be resolved. But fundamentally, I believe that I think that our historically, our thinking in our families really does not provide of an independent thinking of commerce, because there are joint families and people tend to depend on the elders to decide what is to be bought and what is to be sold. Unlike America, you get that education of what is revenue, what is expense, very early in your life. So one lesson that I believe that we all can learn is that some of our incubation program must address that issue, that largely the entrepreneurs that we do create here, I mean, not in the IIT, but we do have a lot of entrepreneurs, but that are generally with a trading mindset. That can I take one piece from here and put it here and earn some commission? Now, in that scenario, it does not require, it is a very opportunistic business. So in that, you don't think about creating an enterprise. That is, that I have to worry about capital, I have to distinguish between revenue, cash flow, expense, how much money will I need, and so on and so forth. And it is surprising, and I am not an expert at what people learn in the Entrepreneur 101, wherever it is being taught, that these things are being taught in the manner that they should be taught. It is also, people don't seem to understand. I mean, forget the quality of the weather. You know, I am not a big fan, you know, the VC pitch should be in this form and that form and so on and so forth. But the fundamentals must be clear. But people don't seem to know how much money it will take to run their business. And if they don't know, then they will not create enterprises understanding what kind of funding will it take to do that particular business they have in mind. And if they say that, oh, I want to do this, and but it's going to require, if they knew that it requires $10 million, I wouldn't even go anywhere near it. You know, people should not waste time, because if that's what they want to do, they must size their business according to what is the capital that's available in the market. The other, I think, thing I believe is perhaps lacking is that that the importance of teams, building a team of entrepreneurs, or when you start a company, building a team as sponsors is extremely important. You know, we tend to be all lone rangers saying that, oh, I've got this great product, and once I have designed it, you know, there will be a queue in front of my office for people to buy. That doesn't work. So creating teams is very important at the startup stage, and these must be complementary teams. Not one technologist and another technologist who will keep fighting as to whose technology is better, and the enterprise will never take off. So I think a complementary team at the start with a commitment to live through that enterprise is very important, because there will be good times and there will be bad times. And if you say, oh, I'm going to go hire a marketing manager from Hindustan Lever, and all that is all pipe dream, because where are the people? There's nobody out there who will join unless you demonstrate a successful enterprise. So till that time, you're going to have to rough it out. And so that's why the team is very important. Counter for that is, and I think that's another thing that incubators should worry about, is to provide counseling, continuous counseling to these teams. Because we are all human beings. I have been in partnerships all my life, and I have seen ups and downs, and unless if the two partners or the three partners are very opinionated and then that partnership is going to break. Okay? It is human nature that when there is success, some partners will take credit, and when there is failure, it is obviously somebody else's fault. So continuous counseling through this incubation phase as to why it is important for them to stay together. Which is, you know, because this is like a marriage, because you would like to believe that this is a long-term association and you are going to have to do give and take. And that, I think, is another very important thing that we should all inculcate in these teams that are... The other big issue that I, you know, is with our, with us as Indians, is that we don't like to fail, or we don't like to admit that we fail. And I think that that is another mindset change that must happen at the academic level, is that it is okay to fail, that you will learn something from failure and you will go on to do something else, or you will make your decision based on some different data than you did the last time. So, you know, it is important for people to learn, and it is okay to fail. So, but if I say that I am going to grade you on the success of your entrepreneurship, if there was some grading in that school, then perhaps, you know, it will just reinforce the motivation to say, oh, if I fail, I get 2 marks. But if I succeed, I get 10 marks. I think it is, one must grade them based on the process they went through. I mean, Sabir Bhatia had one Hotmail. After that, he has consistently failed. It doesn't make him good, bad, or otherwise. That's the way it is. One more, pardon me to say this, because, you know, we find these with the entrepreneurs, so that's why I'm just sharing, is that there must be specialized training schedules or training modules in the entrepreneurship course, because, like, for example, web designing, search engine marketing, what all, especially if you are doing an internet kind of a business, and that is more than likely you will do and not go and build a hotel, it is surprising to find how weak most of the entrepreneurs are in these areas. So, you know, whether it's about product marketing, technology marketing, internet marketing, people must, you know, these things need to be taught. Last one, other micro issue, macro issue to my mind is that the collaboration with the industry, whether it is enterprises, whether they are angel investors, whether they are VCs, must be a lot more proactive from the institute side rather than the VC side. I mean, or it may be equal, because, you know, we should not sit and believe that VCs need us, so they will come running to us. No, I think that we need them as much as they need us. So it must be very important that, you know, there is a very active collaboration. And some of the things I thought of is that if you have continuous programs of updates on what's the right program, I mean, projects to be involved in and so on and so forth, so that it helps the entrepreneur align their enterprise with what the industry needs, not what he thinks they should need, industry should need, you know, because more often than not, all entrepreneurs, not applicable to people in the incubation, is that they design a product without insufficient market validation, because the product may even be good, but we don't go and ask whether it is right for this time. It may be ahead of its time, or there are no customers for it, etc., etc. So market validation and a very deep validation, to the extent that, you know, I have now sold something or the other for past 40 years. And one thing I know, that an Indian customer never says no, as long as he doesn't have to buy it at that time. So if you go and ask somebody, what do you think of the idea? He say, yeah, very good, very good. Then come back to me when it's ready. So they never say no. While in US, you will find people up front telling you, I don't think this will work, friend. Okay. So you have to also learn to separate the wheat from the chaff. Is this real? Or, you know, used to be, I remember when I was involved with Hinditron and we used to sell digital computers, we used to always get barraged by our counterparts in the US saying, how come you are not selling as much as you should? We get hundreds of inquiries for literature every month. So I used to tell them, please come and talk to these people who are asking for literature, because they are putting it in the library. They have no budget to buy. So, you know, so, I mean, we have this appetite for learning. And second is that we are not really very, you know, honest in our communication, saying this doesn't work. So it doesn't work. Okay. The other thing is that I think incubators have to decide what are they in the business for? Are they in the business as a social goal, or is it to create entrepreneurs? And to that extent, it is a commercial enterprise. Because we have found, for example, in many of the incubators that we have visited and talked to entrepreneurs, that there are PhD students, professors, please excuse me if I offend anybody, that perhaps they have good products, you know, something around Indian languages and all that, and we get excited and then we never hear from them again. Why? Because, and then I was asking the incubator head, he says, what to do? You know, they are very happy in that cocoon of theirs. They don't want to necessarily face the reality of the market. Now, you know, now at that point, perhaps there should be a program to say, okay, is there a way I can take that IP and sell it to somebody else or create a team around that? So there must be, instead of that idea sitting in some IIT Delhi lab, it can be productive somewhere else. So this, you know, and I think the if the incubators evaluate themselves as to what need are they meeting, you know, and if you have some PhD student sitting there for 4 years, I think that you have perhaps denied some other potential entrepreneur space in that facility. So there must be constant evaluation on some agreed criteria as to what it should be and how the churn within the incubator should take place, because the rate success ratio is very small. So unless you can churn and create a velocity, you know, you will be stuck with, you know, very poor percentage of successful entrepreneurs. But that has to be our criteria for the incubator, that yes, we created 5 entrepreneurs out of 50 which got funding. Forget the success. It doesn't. What is success is that they got funding, that it was the idea and the team was good enough to get funding. So I think that discipline is important. I know that, you know, when a professor comes to sit there and do something, there's nobody who can say no. But again, I think that should be determined by some set of criteria, so that, you know, it's not somebody's personal baby to decide you should go out and not go out. Lastly, I mean, two more points. I think one of the biggest issues in this country, I think, in terms of that why we have not been able to successfully create products. You know, we call ourselves superpower or whatever power we call, we don't create products here. And why do we not create? It's not that people in Infosys or people anywhere else in IIT are dumb to create products, but who will buy their products? There is no market here. And if I have to fund somebody to sell in the US, that won't work either. So there needs to be some, again, and perhaps IIT or incubators, and there may be some collaborative thing that you can do, is to open doors for these companies so that some beta testing, or there are customers who will do beta tests. Because once the beta test is done, somebody understands it's a good product, somebody will buy. But, you know, I have been asking NASSCOM to say that, okay, ask 20 of your top companies to create a cell. That will only do this, that, you know, look at software products from somebody, you know, and either use it internally on a trial basis, give it. But, you know, again, under their innovation scheme, but, you know, it doesn't seem to have happened because everybody is very busy doing what they're doing. But I think that is another thing that we have to somehow influence the system to do, that create a mindset of early adaption. I mean, why does Cisco, Nortel, all these people get, you know, new ideas? They are all not done inside. It's because they go out and try new ideas. Out of that, you know, maybe they will buy a few and that will fail and some will succeed. But you have to go do that. Provided there is a marketplace here, because you can't. There is no way you can say, I will develop a product here and sell it in the US market, because you have no clue what the US market is all about. Okay? And no amount of money will solve that problem. Okay? Frequent mentoring and seminars on industry segment. And lastly, I think that again, and I think something that we've been talking about in Sign, is to establish a network of angels and VCs. That I think the entrepreneurs will feel a lot more safe if they had some kind of a semi-guarantee or a virtual ability to believe that there is funding beyond this. Because, you know, in the end, that is the motivation. If you are going to do 2 years and then to do what? they'll go back and join some multinational. You know, the whole thing would have been wasted. So some way that, or the incubators or DST or whoever can create a fund which gets allocated, but must be then given to companies that deserve that by an external investment committee. But they must feel that there is some, you know, something beyond this horizon that I will get. Then they will be a lot more motivated to do what they are doing. And again, from a policy point of view, one thing that Thai has been working on without any success is to suggest to the government that they must create some financial incentive for angels to invest. Because we sort of view this as, because there is no angel money available today, very honestly. Either people are very busy putting it in the stock market, but now maybe they will put it somewhere else. So if you can sort of compare that investment in a not large sum of 250 lakhs or rupees as what you allow for under DST scheme as R&D, where you get 133% depreciation or something like that, that will, you know, incentivize the angels to take some risks. Okay, if not that, I may at least get a write-off here. Okay? That way you will create a community of angels that that can sustain. Because that ecosystem, as it is, very little money is available where we operate today. I mean, where we are a $15 million fund, there is another fund of $10 million. I think that there is room for $500 million worth of early stage funding. But, you know, there is no money. Converse is also true that there are not enough plans. I mean, we must have seen 1,000 plans and we have funded 7 companies. So, whether it's a good ratio or bad ratio, I don't know. And some of them, and I will just make one last point, I think another thing that you must teach to people is about this business of valuation. That, you know, valuation is irrelevant at the point of when you are starting. If you will perform well, you will get your value. If you build a valuable company, you will get a valuation. But to say I am worth 5 crores or I am worth 20 crores and all that is to me a meaningless discussion. So, you know, with that, at least I can tell you what we think from, and there is, I think, ample opportunity. The reason we only invest in Mumbai and Bangalore is because we believe that we have to be near our companies. So we don't invest in Delhi. So, you know, there must be seed funds which are in geography so that they can, because it is a lot of hand-holding, I can tell you that. There is, it's not phone calls and say, ha, aisa kar lo. Because there is nobody there who understands, aisa karo, maine kya karne ka hai. Okay, you have to make them, make the connections. So it's a lot more beyond just academically teaching people what is a business plan and what is what the form of a VC pitch should be. There's a lot of contextual work that needs to be done. Thank you.
A couple of very important points that he made. Before I open the panel for questions, would any member like to add briefly on whatever they'd already stated?
Or disagree.
Yeah.
Yeah,
please.
It's because Mr. Gandhi mentioned a lot of things that need to be taught. And so in that context, I absolutely agree with every single thing that you've said. You know, and I can also see why you're still receiving, you know, teams, plans, which don't meet up to your expectation. Because it's a fairly new, even teaching entrepreneurship is a fairly new thing that's happening here. You know, most of our 370 institutions are literally in year one of their you know, initiation into entrepreneurship education. Our challenge right now is to teach all of these things to the faculty members so that they get then translated into programs on campuses. But the one thing that we're seeing with some of our mature institutions, Mr. Gandhi, is that, you know, the emphasis on these things is there. What does the team mean? You know, even if you're putting a business plan in the context of a course in classroom, you know, you're not really expected to have a real team around you, right? But the emphasis on team and what kind of a team it would take for that particular business to succeed, you know, that mental exercise is done, you know, so that there is the understanding that there are complementary skills that are required, that there would be different kinds of, you know, leadership dynamics within a certain team. All of that is being taught, you know, either through these theoretical or through even some simulation kind of exercises and other things. And also the emphasis on finance. And of course, you know, we at NEN put a great deal of emphasis on bringing an industry into every single one of these interactions and learning opportunities. So.
To the DST, I think one very important point Praveen Bhai made from a policy perspective is that there truly is no financial incentive for angel funding. You see, if you take the second round funding or third round funding or market funding, that funding comes at a time where there is a reasonable assurance, already existing knowledge, and valuation at that point in time is much more meaningful because all parameters are known. And it is only proper that that falls under the existing policy framework of financing and so on. But angel funding is almost like a R&D investment. And that's a very good suggestion. So perhaps if you could take this as a take back from the thing, as a suggestion, that angel funding up to a certain limit, say 50 lakhs per company or whatever, should be considered as an R&D investment. Although there would be, of course, shares and things like that, but the thing should be considered in terms of incentivizing the angel community. And I hope you heard him very loud and clear when he said that at that stage, when you go to the angels, valuation is meaningless. I gave you an example of how we conducted the valuation of our first company when Rakesh Mathur, Nandan and I did it. It was not done on the basis of any realistic estimate of how much will that product sell or something like that, but rather how much does the team require to sustain themselves to build up a company. And from that requirement, as I said, Rakesh Mathur said, look, I think if I'm doing, I mean, at that time the term used was not angel funding, it was just funding. Says, I think I should have a 20% stake because I've been mentoring them, I'll continue to mentor them. And they need about this much money. Therefore, the valuation of this company in my mind is this much. Now, this might appear very arbitrary, but believe me, at the angel round of funding, there are no other parameters known. So Praveen Bhai, of course, said it very explicitly that valuation at that stage is crap. However, it is not totally crap because when a funder like him sits to evaluate people at that time, he has this uncanny ability to judge individuals' ideas and so on from a long-term perspective. That comes out of experience. I don't think even he can give you a logical algorithm of how he does it. But that is what comes out of experience. And that experience and that judgment is very valuable. So that is one point. The second point he made is about the need for angels to be near the action. Angel funders are not, you know, saukars who just give money and collect interest. They are actually part and parcel of the risk that is being taken. So when you think of building incubators in different places, in your own geography, as I said earlier, you must find the local successful entrepreneurs who will either form some kind of a small angel fund there itself or will in turn tie up with the countrywide funds such as his or whatever, and we'll say that, okay, since you are in Delhi, Praveen Bhai, but I am in Coimbatore or I am in Jharsuguda, now if we can set up an understanding, if I know what exactly you want me to do, I can be part of your activity and I can mentor these people on a day-to-day basis, and we could have a weekly conference call with some such thing could be possible. But this connection has to be built by the organization which runs the incubator. Because individual incubating companies will be incapable of doing this. And not only that, VCs and angels will not have any faith in any individual company. The faith will at most be at best be there on the organization which runs. Am I right? So that is one very good take. Of course, marketing is 2 weeks, he has already mentioned, and we shall be running a separate 2-day program on the marketing mantra. So thank you very much, Praveen Bhai. Let's open this panel for questions now.
I am Prasad from India. Sir, I got one or two points where I would like to mention, sir. This is with reference to the time, basically. Sir, may I request you to, work towards creating entrepreneurship chairs in different colleges or journals or material related to the entrepreneurship people, for example. We couldn't see many of the cases which are being circulated, like I have seen NEN or other sources. For example, for HCL chairman speaking, I have attended one of the programs last time at Delhi. If you can have a CD of that sort in the country, probably it can be a wonderful mechanism through which entrepreneurship can be developed or educated. I specifically request that it should work to encourage entrepreneurs to create chairs in different colleges, different institutions in the country, which are really falling short of. Journals also the same case. The second point, sir, the academics and entrepreneurship are altogether different or separated, in the country which we have practiced. There's a need to integrate, but probably, something has to be done by the highest level body where how these things can be integrated. They can be integrated. There's no conflict between academics and entrepreneurship. It can start from school to PG level. There is no need to be crying at the PG level saying that you should become an entrepreneur. After 25 years, we are working, somebody asking somebody saying that you should become an entrepreneur. We should ask somebody to become an entrepreneur even at 10th standard, 5th standard, 6th standard. So that kind of integration has to be brought in the curriculum and the teaching style itself. That's one thing which we are doing at NITI, which I insist on. I got a specific, incubator cases, for example, if you would like to search for, I don't think any incubator cases I get in the net or in Indian cases. Like madam was saying, there are 45 incubator cases in India. For example, I have seen Trivandrum or somewhere, there's a good incubator. ICSA Park got incubator award. But probably we need to have cases otherwise, how I can model myself saying that I should become one more sign, I should become one more ICSA Park. I request the DST to promote the cases so that we'll get a handful of cases, we can understand what are the models that are working for that. This is one thing. I got a specific.
I'd just like to add this thing. We are shortly initiating a study and wide range of documentation on the incubators as well as the successful companies as well as the failures also.
That one.
Okay.
For example, faculty development programs initiated by DST has got 2 weeks program, 15 days program. I understand. I can't understand how a faculty can spare 15 days time for this thing. Today we got T20 programs, 20 overs cricket we are playing today, and we got 15 days training program for entrepreneurship development. I think actually after 15 days, I think it will dissipate rather than really get inspired. I submitted a program for 2 days program where DST, the EDI says that you are not eligible to get a 2 days training program for faculty. I really got surprised. Anyhow, these are 4 comments which I made it. I request the panel to address or whatever is that. Thank you very much for this.
Can I, you said something about Thai, so let me answer that. Thai has an active ENP, what we call Entrepreneurship Nurturing Program. What we do find that students don't join. Okay. Although we have significantly reduced fees for students. So perhaps, you can work with Thai to maybe the college can fund it, or we can reduce the cost further to make sure, because we also have an organization to run. So it's not that we are, making profits out of this. But, and we can create a separate mentoring group that can work with your, the entrepreneurship, and that's offer open to all chapters in all cities, that we have entrepreneurs who know little more than what these kids do. So we'll be happy to work with these groups of people. I think they are best suited to give you circulation on where there is success, or because we don't have access to all that data. So, but I'm saying Thai is more than happy to work with you on a longer term basis. But that again goes back to my earlier statement, is that you need to identify the need and proactively reach out. I mean, we don't dream about this, I must go and offer this to NITI or IIT. You need us as much as we need you. So, please.
I'll just comment on the need for the cases that you mentioned and the initiative which DST is taking, as mentioned by Dr. Anita Gupta, on the not only just cases but the entire gamut of field. I'll tell you one problem which I have faced time and again on this documentation. Either there is very little documentation available, or there is a plethora of documentation which has not been classified and summarized. So what happens today, technically I have access to each one of the 45 websites which will describe all the 45 things. Technically I have access to all the websites of NEN and everything that they do. So either it is too much information from which I cannot cull out exactly that small portion of information which I need for a specific purpose, like setting up an incubator, or doing marketing, or attracting and accessing VC funding. Now, each one of these things have each one of these. Perhaps a time has come to exploit the flexibility of markup language on the internet and create three levels of documentation. One is completely a summary sheet of all the internet links that are available, but classified according to the needs. So it is perfectly all right if the same link appears twice. However, if the entire link opens to give me a 20-page document, whether I access it for marketing or whether I access it for VC funding is not good enough. So each of these links should then be reorganized as multiple pages, one page for a particular theme. And I think the links should be organized on that summary page. So if I'm looking at VC funding, then any one of these 45 sites I visit, I don't get 20-page document from each, but I go only to those paragraphs or those sections which relate to VC funding. I would suggest that in the case you are collecting this documentation, we would be very glad to provide some kind of an organizational structure. Because this will probably be far more helpful in quickly relating to. Poini has a question.
Yeah, this is again to Dr. Gupta. Praveen Bhai mentioned about, you know, fiscal incentive about the angel investment. Now, 7 or 8 years of experience at SINE, we have also observed a very little participation from the industry, not only for, you know, taking the product as a market validation, but also, you know, in terms of their participation in investing in startup company, which has a large resources to, you know, actually invest in the company. So just like fiscal incentive, you know, for angel investor, perhaps some kind of fiscal incentive, you know, risk capital by per se at a very early stage can be treated on par with R&D. And if I'm not mistaken, this was also, this both the proposals were part of the planning commission's, you know, report that you indicated. Yeah, so I think something on that, if you are taking the first comment with you, then this is another comment.
They are the same actors.
Same people, exactly.
They are the same people who prepared that paper.
Exactly,
okay. Point is that we have been shouting from the rooftop for last 3 years. Nobody is even blinking. So, you know, maybe if it goes under DST as under, you know, because we don't understand how, you know, how to make something work in.
I think, you know, DST did a fairly good job to get some kind of fiscal incentive for incubators and...
Incubators happened by chance.
Right. So, by the way, Praveen Bhai, incubators as well as incubating companies working within the incubator do not now have to pay service tax for anything. It's a small soap. Yes.
It's a very small thing.
Correct.
No, Nalin, I have known for a long time. But Nalin is more involved in SME segment.
Yes.
Okay, and hence he's the old industry. So, you know, for him, this VAT and service tax and perhaps are more important than, you know, getting an angel funding.
Maybe we could, as a consequence to this workshop, Dr. Mukta Atre, could you note this point? What we should do is we should write a formal letter consolidating all the points that have emerged and explicitly suggest to DST that in order to encourage angel funding, where essentially they are taking a huge R&D risk like any other R&D, perhaps the department might be kind enough to moot a proposal to treat investment up to a certain point as an R&D investment or expenditure rather than anything else.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's an excellent idea. You know, one of the comments somebody made in the government was ke bhai, it shouldn't be ke bhai, baap apne ladke ko paisa de, 50 lakh rupiya, and take. You know, so there is, I mean, we are very creative there also, no?
In fact, this is very interesting, and this shows another mindset. And as he said, we are very creative, so in the country such things do happen. But unfortunately, if 2% of these things happen, 98% of the normal people fail. But because of this problem, the government has to ensure that the larger good happens, and that the provisions are not used by individuals for sort of self-sustenance. And that is the object. But if we apply these rules specifically to those situations where companies have been evaluated independently, admitted to an incubator, and then this angel funding is going, same conditions that you put, probably it would make sense. Look. Any other questions?
Gandhi, I was wondering if you had sort of a specific due diligence kind of checklist that you go through with companies that you're evaluating of, you know, very sort of precisely the kinds of things you're hoping they've taken care of by the time they come to you?
Well, no. I mean, you know, very honestly, you know, at the level we are investing, there is nothing to do due diligence on because it's two people and a plan. So I don't know what I can do due diligence on. So we do, of course, do reference checks on the individuals who are asking. If the company is a little more mature, we go through. But again, they are never in any significant revenue mode so that, you know, there is the balance sheet or P&L has any meaning. So I would say maybe there is some 10% worth of due diligence in terms of reference checks and all that. Otherwise, as Dr. Fatak said, that it is essentially a gut feel or in the interaction with the entrepreneur, saying, does he understand what he is or she is doing? And that's very important, that it's not, we cannot do any DCF calculation on some spreadsheet because nobody knows. So, and it is likely that the business plan will change within the first year. So, you know, all that is irrelevant. So you basically bet on the team. And we are very big on team being the bigger criteria than the idea.
Excellent point he made. Sorry, there's one more question. I'll comment on this later.
Manohar from Manipal. My question is, when I have gone through this series of lectures, a lot of information I gathered. Today, Professor Amarnath said there is a TEP funding. If you look at DST, there is a fund for setting up the incubator. If you look at basic fund required for anything, venture capitalists are there, angel funding is there, everything is there. In spite of this, why things are not happening? Probably my understanding goes, it is not being percolated down to every nook and corner of the country. I think there is a lot of such initiatives are required. If I look at DST and incubators where they are located, mostly for the sake of some risk covers from DST kind of organization, they are found in most of the government organizations. That is the first point I would like to point out. And when you ask some regions, if you look at the entrepreneurship capabilities, they are quite strong in that. But when it comes to government support is concerned, I don't see anything. Whether it's the ignorance of the people or whether it's a government mechanism which has not initiated this type of entrepreneurship awareness in those regions is not very clear to me. I think you can comment on that.
Please use the microphone.
In fact, South private players are very proactive. In fact, I must say. VIT, Congo,
yeah, and as a country,
Banari Amman.
Yeah.
They're all proactive in getting our support.
Yeah, but as a country.
So, as far as DST concerned, we need not make any distinctions between the private and the public. As long as the proposal is sound enough, we are ready to support to
extent. I will add to that in more than one respect. This is a perception coming from the old days that the departments will typically fund only the government institutions. That is no more correct, not only in this case, but any other correct. But the fundamental distinguishing and defining feature is the quality of proposal made and the commitment seen within the proposing institute to that wage. If it is seen to be made, the proposal is seen to be made just to grab some money, which unfortunately is the case several times. And that is not necessarily only from private institutions, even from government institutions. The departments are now clever enough to figure that out and refuse such a support in either case. Am I right, Dr. Yes. Yes.
Yeah, that is most important because yeah,
very, very important.
There are few places,
yes,
even the committee members have made a comment that proposal is strong, but you are a private institute, we are not in a position to keep.
No, they might be stating so on the face of it, but that is not the correct statement.
One comment which I would like to make regarding private institutes, we would definitely seek more commitment and more contribution, a sort of a matching in most of the cases to just to have their more commitment on the proposal. And that's the only thing, because private institutions cannot give that much of funding. So that is the only, and we purely go by the merit of the proposal.
Let me also comment on the scale that you mentioned. What you say is not true, even if the information is available. Take the case of angel funding. You would have heard what Praveen Bhai said. They would have examined something like 1,000 proposals. They found only 7 worthy of support. So please understand that the quality of proposals which are coming for funding are probably very atrociously listed. Where without any understanding of what a funder will look at, probably the sense of commitment that he sees. You know, he clearly stated, and that is exactly what we also learned earlier when Kamal used to mentor us as the startup incubator. You know, incubator itself was a startup. So he gave us a couple of hints, you know, always look into the eyes of the people, try to judge the fire in their belly. At the initial stage, we are even before angel funding. We don't even know what will happen. But as we progress further, is there a commitment? Is there a commitment to sustain the good and bad times? Now that judgment, the incubators have to make, and such well-judged people only should come. Just as quality of proposals from the proposers of incubator is not adequate many times, similarly, proposals for funding from the incubating company is also atrocious. I don't know whether I shared with you or not, but as a part of the Thai activity many years ago, I had created an event where the startups were supposed to give their pitch in 90 seconds, 1.5 minutes. And we had a lot of Thai charter members, supporters, sponsors, and VCs accumulated. And many startups asked me this question, how can we tell everything that we want to say of importance in 90 seconds flat? And I told him what Kamal had told me, which is, if you cannot convey your major pitch to me in 90 seconds and get me attracted, I will not be willing to spend 9 minutes with you. And if in those 9 minutes, if I give you, if you are not able to convince me, then I am not going to spend 9 hours with you. So the pitch has to be made at different levels, and you have to convince people. And that's the reason why when I said, you know, levels of documentation, I think there has to be a 2-minute pitch, a 20-minute pitch, and a 20-hour pitch. And the appropriate pitch must be made at appropriate time. This applies to proposals, this applies to evaluation. In fact, this applies to life in general, I would think.
Yeah, so can I comment?
Yeah, please.
Our experience also indicates that most of the institutions, about 70% approach us for funding of TBI only to strengthen their equipment base. That is their sole interest. Okay. So, until unless they are conceptually clear about the incubation, what all goes into it, it's very difficult to get it going and have success incubator program. So, I'll request Professor Fatak, if this program can be actually organized twice in a year, we'll be ready to support. You target about 30, at least 30 institutions in one program. So, if you are able, if we devote time to educate institutions about the conceptual framework of incubation and entrepreneurship, I think we will then be able to get very good proposals and the effectiveness of the incubation program will also be enhanced.
Can I ask a question to you? Is there a periodic audit of on some criteria on what these incubators do? Because otherwise there is a real estate being wasted. I'm sure.
Actually, the audit is not very formal, but like we have a national level committee which reviews the performance on a set criteria based on the number of enterprises promoted, the incubation process and systems are in place. But we need to have a deeper analysis of the...
I think so. I mean, I think in terms of, you know, the incubative feedback, external industry feedback, because I think in the end you are doing this to service somebody external to the system, not the internal faculty or other people. So there must be some participation from the external world to, you know, in that audit process.
Yeah, in fact, we are having impact analysis of the whole program. But I would like to invite you, if you can contribute and be a part of that committee.
I'm saying I'd be happy to be part of any committee, but in the end, I have been in so many committees, and especially, I mean, I was very passionate because we actually funded this Thai and Stanford program to, you know, we spent a lot of money to create that whole set of recommendation to the finance ministry for what needs to be done for the whole entrepreneurship space. We had, you know, spoken to Montec.
But Praveen bhai, a few things have happened and more will happen. Give us some time. After all,
I am not a very patient person.
That's the problem. But if you look at India, you know, the Indian philosophy, what is time? It is infinite, you know. But anyway, I would just like to mention a couple of points here. Because this audit, what he says, is extremely important. See, as a control system engineer, we have some very fundamental sort of mindset. What we talk about observability and controllability. If something cannot be observed, you cannot make measurements. If something cannot be measured, it cannot be controlled. And if something cannot be controlled, you cannot optimize. Now, if our ambition is to optimize the whole set of incubators, then the auditing in terms of measurement, in terms of understanding, and to be invoked formally would be a very good idea, I think, what he mentioned. I would just touch upon one point, which is completely different, sort of parallel. The revenue model that you had mentioned about the incubator, and you had suggested that the following should be the revenues for day-to-day running and so on, and you had mentioned about the rental and such services, money for such services from day one. I had shared this with the audience here, but I will repeat this. When I started the pilot incubator here, I had exactly the same model in mind. That model required the startup companies to invest some money to begin with from day one. At that time, such investment or angel or funding was not available. And we estimated about 5 to 6 lakh rupees per year company will have to spend. In those days, the heydays of internet, we used to get large number of applications. Everybody wants to incubate. But one fellow said, my father wants to meet you. And the father came and he said, what if they will fail? This brings me to his question. The incubators must proactively work along with other entrepreneurship spreading agencies in your region to remove this stigma of failure in the society's mind. Very important. So this father said, what if this fellow fails? And I told him, look, these are IIT Bombay BTECs. They will always get a job. So what's your problem? But he says, suppose after 1 year, when my son has a loan of 2 lakh rupees on his head and he takes up a job, who will marry him? So the stigma of failure, so I actually called Kamal and Nandan and said, I have a marriage problem. And he did not understand. And I told him that people are not willing to take the risk because of this failure. So if you want to make them pay in the first year under any guise, believe me, the experiment will not succeed. Then Nandan said, all right, part of my donation you divert for this and use this to give free services to people. That is when we conceived of a stockholding model, where we said we'll hold 3%, 5%, 6%. To this date, that continues. However, that does not give any cash flow to the incubator. The cash flow will come only when we discharge in the first round of funding, let's say one-third of our holding and so on, and the amount may differ drastically, and the amount may not come in the first 2 or even 3 years of the incubator. So I would strongly suggest that your funding probably should have a strong relook at the assumptions made on the viability of the incubators and should ensure that no matter what, for the first 3 years, the running expenditure for the incubator, including the people, services, etc., etc., is provided for through the funding.
So 100%
fully met. Fully met for the first 3 years. Of course, during the first 3 years, they are expected to start generating through the discharge of this thing, and they will accumulate those funds so that they can be self-sustained. In general, the world over, very few incubators are self-sustaining. All of them depend on some kind of support or something. Most of it comes from the government. But my worry is that if we don't take care of this, then every incubator that you fund, you may end up doing what I call subcritical investment. And all of those 50 will die in eventually. Whereas even if you choose, say, 20 of those and say for 3 years we underwrite your expenditure, meanwhile, however, these are the parameters of judgment. So we are not asking you for money or something, but tell us how many relationships you have built with the VCs. Tell us how many local successful entrepreneurs have come and mentored your people. Tell us what you have done to educate the incoming companies, monitoring them. These are the parameters on which you will be judged. So annually, I will release you a grant for next year, provided you have done all of it. Do you agree with this?
Very much.
Yes. So give them a 3 year support, and I think that will help a lot. I don't know whether the audience agrees with this suggestion. Yes.
I think it's a very important point, and I think as a matter, while we are teaching people about business models and all that, I may recommend that the incubators themselves must create a business model for its own, which will tell you that, yeah, if I can only exit after 3 years, 5 years, this is the amount of money I will need, so and to improve my success ratio, how many companies must come through the incubation process so that I can make some money in that discharge of 3%, which can create a self-funding. So it has to be also looked at as a business. I mean, yes, government is there, it will fund, but I would like to believe that the incubators must proceed on the basis that they can become self-sufficient at a point in time. Whatever else you give them can go towards the... So, I mean, before we teach everybody about how to run, make business plans, I think we should make one ourselves. Right?
Yes, yes.
Sustainability model also is a function of the location of the incubator.
That is true.
You can't have the same set of performance parameters for incubator located in Bombay vis-a-vis which is located in Bagalkot in
That's
okay. But even the technology trust area.
Correct.
The point again being that some things are going to require 10 years. I mean, it's a business I fund. If I say that this, before it becomes a successful, it's going to need 4 years worth of funding, so be it. I know that. There are some which says that within 24, see, one of the things we do very clearly in our investment is that one criteria is that within 18 to 24 months, the company must be break-even or profitable. I mean, that's the... Many people argue with us that, you know, that excess thrust on profitability may be taking away from market share. We argue that, you know, in the end, money is the most important, revenue is the most important criteria. Market share will come. If you are successful, market share will automatically come. Before we end, I want to emphasize that I think some of the point that you didn't, which I think is having been in partnerships all my life,
this business about counseling, you know, through the incubation, an HR function is a very, very important. Please, if you want the teams to sustain through the incubation and later to keep the team intact is, I think, a very important thing, because most of us fund teams, not necessarily the idea. Yeah, idea is there, but it is the team that gets funded. See, okay, idea nahi chalega, toh there the team is good enough to come up with another idea. But their being together over time is extremely important. So please don't...
Thank you very much, Praveen Bhai, for emphasizing this point again. Again, I don't remember whether I shared this experience or not, but in our early days of mentoring, when a team, a company had got funding from SIDBI, I think, and there was a breakup between the two partners. They were trying to do marketing in the US, but the breakup was so strong that both of them were pursuing their independent things. And SIDBI was terribly worried as to what would happen to their investment. So I had actually gone to US, and without telling them that I am sort of trying to do a conciliation, I called both of them at the same time in my hotel room. And they were very surprised to see each other. They were not willing to even talk to each other. I made them talk to each other. Unfortunately, they had gone beyond the break point. All that I could resurrect was the breakup was proper and legal, so that there were less hassles for the company which stays back. But I realized that had I spent more time with them, had I anticipated that there are some problems, as a teacher, I could have mentored them perhaps earlier, avoiding this. So retaining the team is very important. And about ideas, as he said, this is something which many of us don't understand. When a technology startup happens with some idea, all of us appear to insist in our mind that it is the same idea which must be taken to the market. More than 50% of the time, that will not happen, because the idea might be good, the market would have changed. So this is the Kamal's mantra, which I have learned and I always remember. Do not fall in love with your own idea. Unless the market falls in love with your idea, the idea is useless, however great it may be. So you should be willing to change, not only slightly modify your idea, but willing to change completely. And if you have to change completely, what matters then is the team, which has understood how to build a business, which has understood what a customer is, which has understood what a cash flow is, and which has understood how to get the new team, new technology, and go ahead. Because the idea is to build a successful business. Okay. While technology is important, it is only it's correct. So I think on that note, we'll conclude. Thank you, Praveen Bhai. Thank you, Professor Amarnath. Thank you, Dr. Anita Gupta. And thank you, Sunita.